we really appreciate Pastor Ray and Jared opening up their church for this. So anyway, thank you guys. Okay, so today our topic is, why is my worldview better than yours? Some of you have a program. There wasn't very many printed up, so maybe you're the lucky one to get one tonight. I wanted to remind you that this is sponsored by, it's called the Vancouver Science and Religion Discussion Group. There's also one called Westside Science and Religion Discussion Group, and these are both at meetup.com. So if you go to meetup.com and search for atheist or Christian, you can find a lot of these kind of events. And we have a lot more coming up. So this is kind of an interesting thing we do where we get Christians, atheists, or people of different beliefs together and kind of have a community get together and try to understand each other. So today our presenters are Ray Lubeck. He's one of the pastors here at Endeavor Church and also a seminary professor. And we have Sylvia Benner, who's with CFI-Portland. And I'll give each one an extra minute to explain what their organization is and maybe what events they have. And then we'll launch in to a presentation, so according to our guide. Now, did we agree that Sylvia's going to go first?
No, I'll go ahead.
Okay, so we're going to start with Pastor Ray. And they're going to give short presentations, only 10 minutes each. So it'll be very brief. After that, they'll have a five-minute section where they can cross-examine each other or ask a question of something they think is a burning issue from their side. So 5 minutes for one to question the other, and 5 minutes for the other one to question the other one. And then I'll spend about 5 minutes asking a question of each one. And then we'll open it up to audience Q&A, and that should be for at least 40 minutes. So it should be an intensive time, or an extensive time, for the audience to be involved. So I think you'll find the presentations go really fast. So with that, we'll open up and we'll start with Sylvia. So Sylvia, you have 10 minutes plus an extra minute to explain what CFI-Portland is.
We have a phone here, right?
Okay, hi. My name is Sylvia Benner. I am a coordinator for Center for Inquiry Portland. We are a local branch of a national and international organization called Center for Inquiry. And we are here to promote science, reason, secularism, and for inquiry in all areas of human endeavor. That's what our work is, and we have lectures, and we have book clubs, and movie nights, and we have a Portland Humanist Film Fest coming up on November 11, 12, and 13, that's Veterans Day weekend. It's gonna be happening at Cinema 21, and so you're all invited to come. More information is on our website at centerforinquiry.net. And on Meetup, where you can also find CFI groups. All right, so tonight's topic is why is my worldview better than yours? And this is one that's dear to my heart. I intend to support the position that the secular humanist worldview is is superior to the theistic worldview in some very, very important areas. And that it is equal to the theistic point of view in one area where people consistently think our worldview fails. So I plan to argue that. So first of all, I think I need to distinguish exactly what I mean by worldview, because can people hear me? I think, am I close enough? Okay. There are two aspects to the worldview. One is quite simply the set of beliefs that I have about the world. But the other, and I think the more important aspect of my worldview, is the methodology that I employ to arrive at those beliefs. And I think this is where the biggest difference is in our methodology. So the way I would evaluate the quality of a worldview, if we're to talk about, you know, what is good and what is better, is first of all, a worldview should accurately represent how the world actually is. There's all kinds of stuff you can believe about the world, and some of it's simply so, and some of it's not. So that's a very good, and I think the most important question is how accurate a description of the world is your worldview. I think another important way to measure the quality of a worldview is what kinds of results does it produce out there in the world? And this is one that I think isn't quite so important, but it's the one that seems to be very important to theists, and since I'm speaking to mostly theists, I'd like to address this one too, and that's the issue of How much meaning does your worldview provide? Do you have a narrative into which you can place yourself that gives your life a context? And in secular humanism, the answer to that is most emphatically yes. So let's begin with this question of accuracy. Now, I'm not going to sit here and argue that my worldview is right and yours is wrong, Ray. Obviously, we know this, and we have had that discussion, and we can have it ad nauseum, and there's not going to be much there. Rather, what I'm going to argue is that my worldview employs a sound methodology, whereas the methodology of faith is a profoundly flawed methodology that doesn't have a track record of producing very good results in terms of you know, hitting upon the right conclusions. So let's talk about what I see as the Christian way of knowing, the theistic way of knowing in general. One is revelation, and the other one is feeling. And some people might say, well, that feeling, that internal experience, that's a personal revelation. So, you know, whatever you want to call it. Let's say, essentially, there's the document, and then there's how I feel. So, let's begin with this feeling issue. And in the recent issue of Inquiry, Brian Dalton, who does a comedy show called Mr. Deity, questions that feelings are a reliable indicator of truth and value. He says, I could not help but see that conflating good feelings with truth and value was merely stacking the deck in favor of anyone who could tell a good story. Clearly, people of other faiths had these same deep, warm feelings about their salvation doctrines. Were their good feelings less indicative of truth than mine? So that's essentially what I say is a summary of the critique of why feelings just aren't a very good indicator, because a lot of people have a lot of feelings about a lot of things. None of it gives you any objective reference point for determining what is and isn't. So the other one is biblical revelation. And of course, the Bible is a profoundly flawed document. When you read it without assuming that it is the Word of God, it becomes very obvious that it is qualitatively no different from any of the other mythologies that people have come up with around the world. And without an objective reference point, you really have no way to say, well, is the Bible the right one? Or do the Hindus have the right one? You know, what about the Tantras and all that stuff? There's a lot of stuff out there in the world. There's Greek mythology, you know, the Aztecs had their own mythology. How do you determine what is and isn't accurate? So the Bible in and of itself isn't a very good reference point. And of course, you know, if you're interested, Bart Ehrman has a great series on biblical criticism. And you know, and if nothing else, you read Tom Paine's Age of Reason, and there you go. The way of knowing of a humanist is a different one. We use a methodology that I term free thought. And I'm going to go to the Wikipedia definition because it's nice and concise. Free thought is a philosophical viewpoint that holds that opinions should be formed on the basis of science, logic, and reason, and should not be influenced by authority, tradition, or other dogmas. Now, the advantage of that is not that it always gives you the truth, but the advantage of that methodology is that when you have new data or better theories, you're willing to ditch the old ones and make a better decision. So, you know, when prayer and fasting didn't work against the plague, maybe antibiotics did. That's what free thought does, okay? Those are the results we produce. Now, that moves us straight into the question of how good is the secular humanist worldview for society. And the most obvious thing that I notice is that human history has a very, very clear breaking point when things got significantly better. And that point is the Enlightenment in the 18th century, and then the application of Enlightenment ideas during the 19th century, and things were much, much better after that. Christianity had centuries to do away with things like torture, religious persecution, feudal system, suppression of speech and freedom of conscience, and to put in place systems that would promote societies that would take care of people, including poverty, solve actual social problems, and they didn't. Where the Christian church was dragged into the notion of human rights and individual freedoms, after they were soundly trounced by Enlightenment ideas, and they were failing miserably against these new ideas that said people are in fact equal. There's no such thing as the divine right of kings. We can find out things by investigating them. The church was wrong about the geocentric cosmology. We do in fact live in a solar system, and the Earth does in fact revolve around the sun. Little embryos are not in fact contained in male sperm, in tiny, you know, like the matryoshka dolls, nested smaller and smaller. In fact, it does take the female egg and the male sperm to make other human beings. So over and over and over again, the church was proven wrong scientifically, and it was proven wrong ethically, and not just the Catholic Church. The Presbyterians hung Tom Aikhead for denying the virginity of Mary in Scotland in 1698 or 97, I don't remember the exact year. But, you know, so it's the churches in general. After the Enlightenment, the secular Enlightenment that stood for challenging the authority of the Bible, we suddenly got advances in human rights. We got notions of democracy, freedom of speech, freedom of religion, freedom of conscience, the abolishment of torture. Then came women's rights, rights of blacks, and the methodology of science and reason. In medicine, we came up with the germ theory of disease, antibiotics, painkillers, vaccines, and public health measures. You know, technology. The cotton gin made a huge difference. Steam. Watts was a very prominent figure in the Scottish Enlightenment. We got public sanitation, we got railroads, we got airplanes, we got agricultural science. This was in the 20th century, the Green Revolution. We got all kinds of advances that we didn't have before. And these advances did not come because the people, you know, they were the Christians who made the discoveries, and they were atheists who made those discoveries. But the advances didn't come because of the methodology of faith. The advances came because of the methodology of science and reason. And this methodology is vastly superior to the methodology of revelation, faith, and internal feelings. So let me skip over the rest of the stuff I was going to say there and go straight into meaning and narrative, because I hear this a lot. How can you not despair? How can you not be depressed? I want to read something that Richard Dawkins wrote. He says, after sleeping through 100 million centuries, we have finally opened our eyes on a sumptuous planet, sparkling with color, beautiful with life. Within decades, see? We have inspiration.
I can use some extra time.
Okay. I'm going to skip over that because we're not going to have enough time for it. It is absolutely spectacular to be alive and to experience the world. And we have a narrative on top of the emotion that my worldview brings me, knowing that every atom I am made of was made in a star billions of years ago. But we also have a story that we act in, kind of like the big battle between good and evil, what Christianity has inherited from Zoroastrianism. We have made progress as human beings, and we have made progress because we have applied reason and human resources and science, and we have made life better for humanity on the planet. And I project my mind into the future, and I see how much better we can do, how much better our lives can become, how many more scientific breakthroughs we can have, and what the potential is for humanity. And that's the story that I live in. That's what I'm trying to promote. And that's the narrative that secular humanists live in. And that's what inspires us.
Okay, thank you. All right, thank you, Sylvia. Let's have a hand for Sylvia. Pastor Ray's turn to refute everything. So give your position on what's a worldview, and remember, take an extra minute to explain the ministries you're involved in or the events going on here.
Sure, just quickly. This is my home church right here at Denver, so welcome. We have a number of different ministries besides the Sunday morning meetings. We have ministries of outreach to Shepherd's Door. We have a Celebrate Recovery, which helps people who are coming out of various addictions. We have missional community groups, which are engaged with culture in various ways and reaching out to needy people here in the Rockwood area. This site was selected deliberately because it was a high crime, high need, high density population area, and we thought we could make the most difference for Christ here. I'm also a professor at Multnomah University, and you can just check that out online. As far as why is my worldview better than yours, what does worldview do? I'd like to identify several things, as did Sylvia. I would say it gives a perspective for viewing all of life. It's not just another aspect. It becomes a central point of orientation from which we make our decisions about everything else. So it is not merely a philosophy. It is basic. It's prior to philosophy itself. Second thing that it does is that it integrates all of these into a cohesive story of everything. Again, I affirm this idea with Sylvia. It's a meta-narrative that integrates these things so that what I believe about economics will also be coherent with what I believe about law or about social justice and issues. It also gives us a context for living meaningfully. That is, it tells me how I should live. What should I do? Given this set of realities, what's the most consistent way to live with those truths? And finally, like it or not, it screens what we take in. That is, our worldview causes us to pick up on certain kinds of information, and wittingly or unwittingly, it causes us to suppress other things that we just become blind to. And that, by the way, is my chief interest in this kind of dialogue, because I want to be aware of my own blind spots and hopefully help others see theirs. Western philosophy has as kind of its point of origination the writings of Plato, and most essentially what he did was he saw that reality was divided into the realm of shadows and forms, to use his terms, or if we want to reword those ideas, we would say a physical material world in a metaphysical world of ideas. I have heard it said multiple occasions that all of Western philosophy is simply a footnote to Plato. So every worldview is going to have to engage both of those aspects. Is space, time, matter, energy the only reality that exists? Plato was the one who said no. And all of philosophy since then has been dealing with this question. Is space, time, matter, energy real? There are some worldviews that say no. The physical world is not real. Who would say that? Is there reality beyond space, time, matter, energy? There are some who would say this isn't real, but the spiritual part is. And those are pantheists. They would say all of the physical world is maya. It's an illusion. There are those who would say, no, this isn't real, and no, there isn't such a reality beyond space, time, matter, energy. And at least some postmodern theorists would say reality is simply a word that we impose as a social conceptual concept onto our phenomena. On the other hand, there are those worldviews that say, yes, there is such a thing as real matter. Is there reality beyond space, time, matter, energy? And theists, those who believe in God, would say, yes, we believe in physical reality. We believe in the metaphysical reality. Those who are naturalists, or what I would prefer to say, anti-supernaturalists, would reject that there's such a thing as a spiritual reality. I'll tell you more about that in a moment. So, summarize here. Is the natural world real? Pantheists would say no. But they do believe that there's a supernatural world. Naturalists, atheists, most would go into this category, would say, yes, the natural world is real, but there isn't anything else. Theist says, yes, there's a natural world. Yes, there's a supernatural world. A widely quoted psychologist, atheist, by the name of Eisenach, said, if it cannot be measured, it does not exist. In science, only one thing matters, and that is the facts. Now, I find a statement like that very troublesome for a worldview. Let me rephrase it. One should only believe in things that have evidence to support them. Okay, I understand the statement, but it's self-defeating. And what is the evidence to support this asserted belief? Is there scientific evidence to show that that statement is true? And what do you believe constitutes valid evidence? What are you going to count as evidence? And what evidence do you have to support your belief in what constitutes evidence? You see how it keeps going back? My point? Science can neither prove nor disprove non-physical reality. It simply dismisses it out of hand. It doesn't refute it, it simply says it doesn't compute. So, the metaphysical world, for them, merely disappears, which seems to me a flawed methodology. Is science the basis of a worldview, or is a worldview the basis of a science? And as I've engaged with other atheists in the past, as well as in these dialogues, it appears to me that the claim is made that science is the basis of their worldview. And what I would contend is, you can't have it that easily. The worldview comes first. You have a set of beliefs that you carry into your science so that your methodology is paradigm dependent. And there are simply far too many aspects that cannot be measured scientifically. Can you measure value or purpose or meaning or justice or beauty or personhood or joy or transcendence or many of the other things that make up life? For that matter, can you even say that pain is real? It can't be measured. So you have a nurse or a doctor come into your room and asks you to say, on a scale of 1 to 10, what is your level of pain? Well, if they could measure it scientifically, they wouldn't need to ask you. They could say, your level of pain is 5.36. Specialization may be a great temptation for the scientist, that is to zero in on one particular aspect. For the philosopher, it is the mortal sin. We have to address things like value, purpose, and meaning that go beyond what science will ever be able to answer. Simply assuming that only matter is real leaves too many important questions. Like, why is there something rather than nothing? Are things like purpose, beauty, and love real? Is there any non-material reality? Does life itself have any inherent meaning? How do inanimate particles, like atoms, aggregate into something fundamentally different, a living organism, and why? And is this design? Are humans capable of making free choices, and on what basis? Can evolution support the moral basis for dignity of human life? Does anything I do really matter? Is it possible for us to know anything independently of our predetermined models of observation? And there are many scientists who would say no. Like Niels Bohr, Heisenberg, the Copenhagen School, Thomas Kuhn, and other philosophers of science. So I wrote a poem for this occasion. Shakespeare needn't worry about his place in the canon of literature. Suppose we lived in a society where all communication must be poetry. If anything you say doesn't rhyme, then it simply is a waste of time. But you protest, I have sufficient proof. The answer is, no rhyme, no truth. You say, my truths I can clearly quantify. Alas, your statement doesn't qualify. In poetry land, poetry rules. All other claims are made by fools. And now, in our land, you seek to impose your wish. All truth must be scientific prose. If it's not science, it's not real. No other recourse and no appeal. Science is real. Science, that's all. Such a world as yours, I find too small. I'm done.
Okay. You got an extra minute?
Nope, I'm good.
Okay. All right, let's give a hand for Pastor Ray. I take it you can't play a musical instrument, or the song just hasn't come out yet.
Yeah, we'll be releasing that one later. I'll have that. Choreographed and all.
And then we could all rate it, you know.
Let's not go there.
Okay, yeah. Okay, so now it's time. Sylvia was listening patiently, so I'm sure she has some questions for Ray, and so we'll give 5 minutes to have a little communication here. Hopefully it's a back and forth communication where Sylvia can ask Ray some questions, and then we'll have 5 minutes for Ray to ask Sylvia questions. So put Sylvia in the driver's seat for 5 minutes.
I don't know if I have questions for you. I've heard half the presentation seems to have been the same one that we did before, the whole Play-Doh and stuff. Sure. Okay, so first, I do feel the need, however, to correct something that is often misstated about atheism, about secular humanism, about free thought, and of course the methodology of science. Science does not need to prove to disprove the supernatural world. And science does not claim that anything it cannot prove does not exist. If that were the case, we could stop looking for new stuff. Science continues to look for new things to prove. Rather, the free thought position is that if you cannot prove something to be so, there is no reason to believe in it and to live your life like it actually exists, because then anybody can make any number of claims that are not disprovable, mutually contradictory, and you can't decide between them. So that is a very important misrepresentation of scientific methodology and of the atheist position. And unanswered questions, of course, aren't a problem. They are a reason to keep looking. So I have one question, I guess. So you make a claim about God, something supernatural, and you know, you can't prove it, I can't disprove it. So somebody else makes a claim, Ray, we all live in a simulated reality. The world is more like Simulacron 3 or the Matrix, and the reason we can't detect that we live in this reality is because this reality is utterly internally consistent. So now, how do you make a decision between whether the Matrix has it right or whether the Bible has it right?
I suppose that I would employ three different criteria. One of them would be that of coherence. That is, if there's something that is incoherent in this simulated world, then I would have reason for suspicion. Beyond that, we have consistency, and that is, does it seem to relate to life as is experienced? And the third one would have to do with the subjective aspects of it. Is this something that is satisfactory, or does it seem to grate against the very fiber of my sense that I should have free choice, for instance.
Okay, so by definition, in Simulacron 3 and in the Matrix, the authors go to great lengths to make sure that this is an internally consistent reality. So this, when you say coherence,
yes.
Coherent.
I would say that they would pass on that one.
Yeah, so they would pass.
Yeah.
And then the last one is this issue of feeling that Brian Dalton criticizes, is that if you go by feeling, then, you know, there are people who actually do feel we live in a simulated reality. There's a whole cult about we live in a simulated reality, let's break out.
Probably here in Portland too, right?
Yeah, that's the ground zero for that kind of stuff. So I guess how do you pick your sense of what you should be feeling against their sense of what they should be? Because in the Matrix is a very interesting thing. Have you ever had the sense that something just isn't right with the world, something should be different? You know, that's how kind of Neo, that's why I have to basically talk Neo into realizing he's living in a simulated reality.
Sure.
So how do you judge between those people's feelings and yours?
Sure, I think that's a great illustration that you brought, and the answer is already implicit in your illustration. How was Neo brought out of that world? And it was because he was brought into encounter with things that he had suspected all along that just didn't seem to work inside of this. So there are ways of testing this with consistency. By consistency, what I mean is what I say or what this model is representing also accords with what I'm now understanding in light of all of my experiences. And I wouldn't be so quick to discount feelings. Because once again, I would say that love is a real thing, and yet if I'm locked into that lower world of Plato, and that's all, then all I can say is that love is simply a rush of oxytocin with maybe a little bit of epinephrine thrown in.
Okay, so I want to make one other distinction. There seems to be some conflating of concepts again, you know. So, you know, we're talking about love as evidence for something else, or feelings as evidence for something else. That if the feelings are real, it's quite evident, and in fact we can measure them. We can't quantify them yet, but we can detect their existence as neurological states. However, there's a very important other thing that, you know, when we talk about belief, there's of course, belief is often used in the sense of value, whereas your quotes here use belief in the sense of belief in the existence of something, or belief in a fact, believing the truthfulness of something, which are two different. So this equivocation doesn't quite work in terms of an argument. But okay, I got your answers, and we could, you know, argue more.
All right, thank you. And you know, if this sparked, hopefully this may spark some ideas, and then the audience can ask questions later. So Ray, now you're in the driver's seat, and hopefully we'll have a conversation here, and I would like you to maybe ask Sylvia some questions, maybe clarify what she said, or poke some holes in something you think she said is totally
sure.
wrong or something.
One quick response first, and that is, in our previous two conversations, and again tonight, one of the things that I've been driving at is to say, atheists seem to want to base their worldview on science, and what I keep trying to push toward is to say, you believe, you have faith. And faith that is even prior to evidence. It's faith that causes you even to accept what is evidence and whether it's valid. Okay? Now, let me poke away here. First of all, you mentioned a number of things, a lot of things I really agree with. I won't go there. One of the things that you mentioned is that a worldview needs accurately to represent the world as it is. And I just have a comment there, and that is that the form of naturalism that I've seen surfacing in these debates have not told the whole picture of all atheists, because they reflect only a subset, and that is Enlightenment modernistic thinking. And what's been left out of this equation is postmodern thinking. And postmodern thinking, I think, really attacks at the heart of a lot of the presuppositions of modernistic atheism. It would also say, along with what Christians have been saying for a long time, you have a faith that precedes your methodology. And in fact, Discover Magazine a number of years ago said that evolutionists are finding themselves being opposed by two partners who are unusual bedfellows, Christians and postmoderns. And even if you can dismiss or turn aside arguments of Christian critique of atheism, I think that you have yet to do battle with postmoderns, and there's going to be a lot more that will need to take place there, because they're going to challenge your objectivity in approaching a particular field. So that would be one aspect. You can respond to that.
So the reason I'm only representing the non-postmodernist subset of atheists is because I'm not here as an atheist, I'm here as a secular humanist, and secular humanists are not postmodernists.
Right.
We do believe in an objective reality, you know. And the other thing that I want to say is that science doesn't concern itself with postmodernism much, because postmodernism talk about a self-defeating statement. You know, the thing I try to distinguish belief as a value from belief as belief in the truthfulness of certain statements or propositions, which makes that statement that you call self-defeating really non-self-defeating. It only becomes self-defeating if we equivocate and you pretend that those two things mean the same thing. But a postmodernist, it says things, there is no such thing as absolute truth. That is actually a self-defeating statement, because then that statement isn't absolute truth either. And I have to admit, Ray, you are the very first Christian I've ever encountered who is a Christian and a postmodernist, because those two things are way incompatible in my mind. So that's another dinner conversation, I suppose.
Okay. You say that the methodology of faith has a poor track record, and I would probably just challenge that. on any number of ways. So for instance, you say Christians were unwillingly dragged into social issues, and I would say, no, how did slavery here get abolished, or the civil rights movements? And you'll find that it was William Wilberforce who, on the basis of Christian principles, or Martin Luther King Jr., or others who have been at the very forefront. Women's suffrage was hardly something that started merely with atheists. It was in the churches all over the place. Public health, look at how many hospitals and various kinds of clinics worldwide have been started and maintained by people of faith. I think that you're taking credit for the methodology of science in ways where actually you're simply parasitically jumping onto something that's been around a long, long time. And maybe just anecdotally, at Multnomah, this last week on Monday, we canceled classes for the whole day, and it was a day of outreach. And I spent the day packing lunches for people who had no food. And they knew that there was going to be a giveaway there. And I understand that there are atheists who are involved in upper levels of administration and policy, but I don't see atheists taking a day off of school at a secular university in order to do the kind of face-to-face, hand-to-hand, touching people and caring for them.
Okay. And I think maybe, Sylvia, I'll give you 30 seconds or so, because it was almost an accusation here. So just to let me clear the air a little bit, I'll give you just a very short time.
Yes, maybe there's just
the reason you don't see them is because most of them who are there don't tell you they're atheists, number one. Most of us are in the closet. Number two, I'd like to make a distinction, because there's no doubt that Christians, people in general, including Christians, have been caring for others for a very long time. And that is that human impulse for compassion. What I'm telling you is that having a place to stash plague victims is a very different thing from giving them medication that will treat their disease and save their lives. And the thing that treats the disease and saves their lives, in many cases, is what is developed, not with the methodology of faith, but with the methodology of science and reason. Even if the person who employs this methodology, maybe his metaphysics might be Christian, but the methodology he employs is the methodology of science, the one that's evidence-based, because the stuff that doesn't show that it works doesn't get used for treatment.
Okay.
Okay,
sure. Yeah.
Okay. So all I would say is that the methodology of science does not simply belong to atheists. Christians have been using the methodology of science all along too. And so now it becomes a matter of the methodology of science as practiced by this faith or this faith.
Okay, thank you. And then, you know, the audience could follow on here if they want to also. So now I'll take 5 minutes and I'll ask a question first to Sylvia, because she presented first. I'll give Ray some chance to rest his voice.
And chug this whole thing.
Okay, so now it's my turn to ask you some questions, and maybe we'll have some dialogue too. So my question, on your presentation, you talked about looking at the big picture, and you actually got pretty emotional too about how you want to change the world to be a better place. So now, at a debate recently, there's Christians making the point that atheists really have no motivation to live, really, because, you know, ultimately everything is going to get erased. So even if you can make the perfect world now, it's all going to go when the universe goes. So what's the point of it all? So I mean, how could you even, if you look at the big picture, I mean, maybe are atheists just being naive and saying, oh, just forget about the big picture, just live for now? I mean, because if you look at the big picture and everything's going to be unwound or dismantled, what's the point?
Actually, it looks like it's going to be unwound as you run out of steam. Instead, I don't know that I agree that the permanence of something is the only indication of its value. I mean, our lives are impermanent, so a Christian might just as well say, it doesn't matter, I don't have to relieve your pain, you're going to be gone 30 years anyway. You know, it is about the experience that people have, not just people, I would say, I would expand this to sentient organisms. And I don't know that I need to justify this in any way with any faith or belief. This is how I'm wired up. I'm a member of a social species. I'm not a lobster, you know, I'm not a guppy, I'm a human being. That's how I'm wired.
Okay, so then maybe, it sounds like maybe you might want to rephrase what you said, because it sounds like in your presentation you're saying the end goal is what really encourages you, but now you're saying, I think the journey is what's important, and not the end goal.
Well, it's a set of goals. If we could come up with a way to eliminate hunger, that would be awesome. It doesn't mean that it has to last forever and ever, but if, you know, 20 years from now there's no more hunger in the world, that's a great achievement. That's a good thing. That's a goal, and it doesn't have to be a goal that's 50 billion years from now. It's enough that it's a 20-year goal, 50-year goal.
Okay, so just to throw it at you one more time.
I
hope it's not irritating, but suppose you create the perfect utopian environment and it goes on for a billion years, and the Earth goes on for a billion years, even though it's not projected to live that long, just many millions of years. But let's say, for example, the Earth goes on for billions of years, but eventually, even though it was a perfect world for billions of years, it's all going to get wiped out and dismantled, and for billions of years, billions of billions of years is still a drop in the ocean to eternity. So what's the point?
I'm not a megalomaniac. I'm perfectly okay with making a difference for a decade for someone. I guess I have no way to relate with it emotionally. I don't have eternity as a standard. You know, that I don't know that I've ever had eternity as a standard. When I'm gone, I will not suffer. I will have no consciousness. When the Earth is gone, none of us will, and none of the former inhabitants of Earth will, and who knows what species there will be around. It's not something that it's not relevant outside of the context of conscious experience. When there's no consciousness, all this becomes irrelevant anyway. It doesn't worry me. I'm worried about what's conscious, not what's not conscious.
Okay, since I have a little bit more time, let me develop this thing a little bit further in a little different angle. A lot of people, there's quite a few people who were Christians and now they're atheists, and I've heard that a lot of them struggle with this idea of death, because when you're a Christian, you believe you're going to live forever, and then as an atheist, you feel, wow, I'm going to go into oblivion. And I've heard that some atheists never struggle with that because they never, maybe they struggle with that especially because they were a Christian and they had a hope. So what's your input on that? Is this something that all atheists, if they really thought about it, maybe struggle with? Are some atheists in denial so they don't struggle with it? So trying to deal with this eternity, basically, according to the worldview of atheism. So
I don't know that I'm the right person to address it because I haven't experienced that struggle. Many people report to me that they have had that struggle. I don't, and I think I don't know exactly how Mark Twain phrased it, but he says something like, you know, I was dead for millions of years before I was born and never suffered the slightest inconvenience from it. I'm not worried about all the billions of years that I wasn't alive, and I'm not worried about the billions of years that I'm not going to be. So maybe I lack compassion in that area because I haven't experienced that. It might be better to ask this question of somebody who has struggled with it and overcome it. I've not had to deal with this. I'm pretty sanguine about death at this point in my life. And by the way, I've been sanguine about death when I thought it was imminent, too. So it's not unusual. It's not just because I'm not.
Okay, thank you. Hopefully this sparks some questions for the audience. They can follow up if they want to. Okay, so Pastor Ray, I have some questions for you. I have a relative who is a very strong believer, kind of a Pentecostal believer, and she really believes that prayer will solve things or do things, especially praying for the sick and things like that. And there's one friend they have from church, I guess, she's really involved in the healing ministry, and they have somebody from church who's kind of decrepit in a wheelchair, maybe 10 years old. And for years they've been coming over and praying over it, you know, this is the promise of Jesus, believe in it, you'll receive it. You know, and I was thinking, at first, I could see that could give a lot of hope to the child. But I'm thinking, you know, nothing's going to happen. God's not going to cure this person in a wheelchair. What's going to happen long term? So I'd like to know your ideas on the Christian worldview in that situation. Is it doing more damage to pray this faith, that if you have faith and Jesus is going to heal you because that's the gospel and all that, and it doesn't happen? What's going on there with worldviews and all that?
Prayer is not magic. Magic, to my understanding, is trying to, in some way, manipulate or coerce upper story forces to bend to our own wills. And rightly understood, I don't think prayer is discussed in the Bible is a matter of us coercing an otherwise reluctant or unwilling God into our view of things. Rather, prayer more than anything becomes a way of acquiescing our will to His. Christ Himself faced very, very difficult circumstances, and He prayed. And He said, let this cup pass from me. The cup they're representing, all the punishment that would fall on the shoulders. And He said, nevertheless, not my will, but yours. And I think that's the posture that we need to take into prayer. It can shape our own perception of what it is that we're experiencing and put it in a larger, more transcendent perspective. So to account for the theology of your Pentecostal friends, I would just say, that's only one very small subset, and perhaps there's more growth, more learning. Even the book of James talks about why our prayer sometimes doesn't work, and sometimes it's because we don't know how to pray.
So when this relative, you know, says basically just believe, you have to have the faith, thank Jesus for it in advance, you know, like Abraham did, or people believe in advance of things happening, those are the role models. Would you say that kind of faith or worldview is actually damaging the child, the handicapped child they're praying for, because it's building false expectations?
Yeah, I would say that it's presumptuous. If we say that we can make God do this, or if we only do this, then God will be obligated to follow us. I think there's a flaw of theology.
And it's actually damaging the child because of the ideas it's putting into their head, because maybe they're not worth a miracle or something.
Sure.
They might think things like that, or they're not worthy, or Jesus doesn't like them for some reason.
Sure.
Especially if it's promised in the gospel and they're not getting
it. I would agree that bad theology can damage people, absolutely.
Okay, so...
it doesn't invalidate good theology, but it's bad theology.
Okay, let me ask you a question about your worldview, too, as far as healing. So let's say, for example, a doctor told you, Ray, I'm sorry, but you've got leukemia, and it's really advanced, there's nothing we can do, you have 6 months to live. In your mind, in your worldview, do you think God would heal that if you prayed for healing? Or like 10% chance, or you have no idea, or what?
Bernie, you have no idea. I say that kind of wryly because it wasn't leukemia, it was Hodgkin's. It was what appeared to be stage 4 Hodgkin's, and the percentages that I was given to live beyond 2 years was 20%. So I faced that. Did I think that God was going to heal me? I honestly didn't know. But I knew that it was right to pray and to ask for others to pray. And do I think that God answered those prayers? Yes. Do I think it's because I prayed right or because I got the right people around me? I think that that's in the mind of God, and I won't know probably until I die, and I'm looking forward to hearing the reason. But fortunately, in my worldview, I get to find out the reason.
But the reason why I think it's an interesting question is because there's, like, for example, I mentioned the 4-square denomination. I believe one of the squares is they believe that Jesus will heal, there's healing in the atonement. And I believe that they have a crisis because they've had senior leaders that died from illnesses. So they had a major disconnect with the worldview that they were preaching and what they were seeing, because they can no longer say, well, these people weren't righteous enough or whatever, because they're their own leaders. And I think their denomination is actually in chaos right now over this healing issue. And so it's kind of a worldview healing question, I think.
Yeah, and again, I'm not trying to stand here and defend a particular subset of evangelicalism. If you're asking me about theism or Christian theism as a worldview, yeah, I have to look at things much bigger. Does God heal? Yes, He heals. Does He heal everyone? Well, no, George Bernard Shaw had it right. The statistics on death are quite impressive. 1 out of 1 people die. So whether you die from this disease at this time or that disease at a later time, it's going to happen.